what's up, people?
To the same laws that were put in place.
Long time no see.
And the end result, to suppress turnout.
I'm checking in on.
Deny the ability
of I kept my circle real tight when I was out there in Arizona.
State legislators who are here have come here because they honestly
Big Joe
dearly believe in this concept of
Mickey,
one person.
Gary was like a father to me, local Lomos, crazy hell.
The legislators from Texas ought to go back home and do what
and
they
threw them,
to do.
I'm met a MC and the president's always real kind to me and my wife when we go out there. It's a good club, good guys. But Gary died. I took me and Amy took care of Gary for the last 18 months of his life.
We do that all the time, so I think it's a little disparaging to suggest that these men and women
we have love you, Lee.
Responsibilities when in fact they're using constitutional abilities and guidelines to do what they have to do.
Very much.
Mr. Chairman, I believe more than anything else that when we look at the disappearance of pre-clearance,
Mickey and Lee were a couple. I met Gary and Mickey first. Or I met Gary and Joe first, Big Joe, Engine Joe. He was a gypsy for a long time, but him and Gary, I lived out in Marin, Arizona, Abra Valley, around the corner of Calle Carmela and Derringer. But Gary and Joe were cutting some mesquite down, some standing dead off my property. I was sitting out there on the porch with my daughter, and I was real, this is my natural skin color, and I don't even go outside. I'm darker than most Mexicans, but I was real dark because I was framing for Yarbrough Construction out there, putting houses in stick framing. And they were cutting down, and Joe said, "Who's that black guy over there?" And Gary said, "That ain't no black guy. That's a tan, tatted up white boy." And we got talking, you know, smoked a couple joints. And Joe was freaking out. I mean, just freaking out. And Joe, Engine Joe was a big dude. Probably 6'3", 340 pounds. I mean, he's a big boy. He was freaking out. He was missing a little piece of chain. And what was so special about that chain, I didn't know it at the time. His older brother, Mickey, had found that out by Tombstone, Arizona, right by Sheepshead Mountain. A friend of theirs, Bill, owned a bunch of land, and it was an old abandoned mining camp, and they would dig where the dump was there and find all kinds of cool shit. But it was a hand-forged chain about this long, and it had a round ring on it, but it was all hand-forged, old chain. And Joe couldn't find it. He was in panic mode. I mean, panic mode. And I'm thinking, who the fuck is this Mickey dude? You know, this huge dude's freaking out, terrified. Because he kept saying, "Gary, he'll fucking kill me. He'll kill me, Gary." And we got talking. Well, me and Gary got to hanging out. And Gary became like a father to me. I loved Gary. Taking care of him the last 18 months of his life, watching a big man go down to nothing, getting ate up with cancer, it hurt. It hurt bad. He got incontinent at the end. We were pumping and sure anything we could down him. The man did not complain, not one time. But Gary's the one that talked me down when I got a hold of that dude that threatened to kill my wife and kids. And we lost Gary. And then me and Amy moved back. And I got the call that Mickey was sick. And in the meantime, you know, I had met, living out there for 15 years, I met Crazy Dave. He lives down in Benson, and Redbeard, and Hog Riding Fools. And they were all the Vietnam generation older than me, but every single one of them, they were all good to me and my wife and my kids. And I learned a lot from all of them out there. Crazy Dave, they were driving and they got pulled over. Gary and Dave got a bunch of empty. Gary drank them King Cobra malt liquor. He goes through 8-9 of them fucking things every day. But they're got all these empty 40s on the back floorboard of the car. And Arizona State Trooper pulls him over. He gets everybody's driver's license. He says to Dave, he says, "Where's your driver's license?" And Dave says, I don't got my wallet with me. He goes, "What's your name?" So Dave tells him his name. And he goes, "When's your birthday?" And Dave says, "August 3rd. And the cop goes, "What year?" And Dave goes, "Every fucking year." I mean, Dave was, he's an American hero. He was a medic in Vietnam. His job was to kind of patch guys up under fire and figure out what part goes with what body after the battle. But he's a good man. He's a good man. They're all good people. We got to where Mickey had the cancer. So I went out to say goodbye to Mickey. Last time I was out there, I went out to say goodbye to my stepfather. And I saw Dave and Joe and them. And before that, the trip before that, we got an invite to the clubhouse. Me and Amy went to the clubhouse. Had a good time that night. I woke up outside the hotel in my underwear. I don't drink anymore, but I got to drinking at the clubhouse. Amy said, "Oh my God," she said, "I got drunker last night than I did at our wedding." But I woke up in my underwear outside the hotel and shit. That's when you know you had a good time. But we come back, and then when the COVID hit, Mickey's brother Joe got the COVID. And Crazy Dave, he's got emphysema like I do. He's on oxygen, and he's got a little portable oxygen thing he carries around with him. And they weren't letting nobody in during COVID to see Joe. Crazy Dave snuck in there, and he tripped over his own oxygen cord and broke his shoulder up in Joe's hospital room. And he wasn't even supposed to be in there. He's got emphysema. Joe's actively dying of COVID, and crazy ass Dave busts up in there to see his brother. If that ain't loyalty, I don't know what is. And then, right now, the mother of Joe's children. They were married for a while, and she is a tough gal. I mean, whenever I first met Mickey, Gary took me down to Mickey's. Me and Gary had been hanging around probably about 6 months. He took me down to Mickey's. Mickey lived right by 8 Mile. We'd watch 4th of July there every year. And we get there, I see this little bitty guy walking towards the gate, and I'm thinking, this is the guy that big, huge dude was freaking out about that chain over. And I got up to the fence, and I looked him in the eyes, and I got it. I got it. I understood. Mickey was not a big dude, but pound for pound, probably one of the most dangerous motherfuckers I've ever met in my life. He was something else. I loved all of them. Joe's not doing good. And then Mickey's girlfriend was Lee. I was just chatting with her. Lori's supposed to call me back. When she does, I might have to pause this video, but Lee's got the cancer real bad. It's all over her body. And it really breaks my heart, because Lee is like a flower child. She's peace and love. She's the one that taught me that there's other ways to do things besides violence. She told me one time, why does everything got to be violent with you? Why do you always got to resort to violence? And I learned a lot from all of them out there. It really breaks my heart that Lee's going through that. There's my beautiful wife. And Lori's supposed to call me back here. And then Dave, I sent him a message to check on him, but I haven't got an answer yet. Lori's supposed to be calling me back. She's got pneumonia. I talked to Lee. She's not doing good. Cancer's fucking up. Lori's going to call back, though. I'll just do a video. Well, at least you'll be something pretty in the video. And my point is, I love you. How's your day going? Besides Amy's dad fell down. Her sister found him.
She was very upset when she called, and I think she
was... He's getting near that stage where he's going to have to...
I think it scared her. I think she got it with that.
Yeah, I know it's like to find dead bodies. Ain't no fun. That one me and my cousin Jamie found, that homeless guy in that basement, I'll never get the smell of that out of my... He's all bloated. It was summertime. Well, I don't need to talk about that in the video. It was nasty, though. Okay. Jesus.
Yeah,
chicken strips, I guess. It's Nate Dogg's birthday today. 55 years old. He's an old man. Nate was born 7/6/68, and I was 7/11. 5 days older than me. He's been out partying for 4 fucking days. I told him on the 4th I'm going to run him down to Florida. I'm tired of watching my brother. I don't know how many times I've been in the hospital with Nate. He's had 5 strokes, 2 or 3 heart attacks. Had to get the defibrillator put in. They put a, motherfuckers put a recalled defibrillator in him. So they had to take that one out, and they put a defibrillator pacemaker in. And
I was a state lawmaker for 3 years before I came to Congress. I represent the 1st Congressional District of South Carolina.
I told them the difference between me and you, Nate, is
very bad history.
When I'm sitting on the edge of bed at night and I can't breathe.
I recently took a vote to move.
Or my chest locks up. I don't call 911. I make the sign of the cross, and I pray to my God, and I get ready to meet him.
I voted to move to some of my Glade Hampton,
It's scary. It's scary shit.
Over 100.
And I understand he gets scared too. But you know, just don't make no sense to me. Fuck him. Getting scared and going to the hospital, trying to stay alive, and then wrecking yourself, going out and drinking a party. I can't do it no more.
Right, and I applaud you for.
I just can't do it no more. Hey, he's hurt. He ain't really got nothing left. I mean, his daughter, he's. X ran off with her, left state, didn't even tell him. But we went to court, and he's got visitation rights. I've sent paperwork down to Florida 2 times now. And they keep sending it back, saying they need something else every time. So I told him, don't run up no huge bar tabs, motherfucker. On the 4th of next month, we're going to head to Florida. And I think I know where she's at. I think I know where she works. But I got to make sure. And then we'll go up to the courthouse and pay somebody certified to go serve her. I'm hoping, really, really hoping that, it'll give them something to live for. Yeah, I don't blame him. Well, he's a dead man anyways. I mean, so am I. Just tick, 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 and you don't know when it's going to go. But he's speeding things up. And I'll never turn my back on the brother. We all made a promise to each other a long time ago, and I'm all in on it. I'm so all in on it, I was told to cover a tattoo in prison. They thought it was something that it wasn't, and I didn't cover it up, and that was really stupid not to. They told me I had a week. I couldn't do it. To me, it would have been, number one, I don't like fucking being told what to do. I'm stubborn, stupid like that. Number two, to me, it would have been like changing my last name. Those guys that I ran with, those are my family. Nobody in my family fucking talks to me. I hear from my Uncle Bobby when he needs a ride to the doctors or something. They don't talk to me.
No, I did not. 63%. Do you know what percentage of Hispanics?
I don't go around the family no more because of my father and my stepmother.
Hispanics are.
It's best for the family, you know, because.
Do you know?
I'm to the point with my father, well, I'll match punch for punch and I'll match shot for shot, and my family don't need that. And I haven't told everybody in the family about, my Uncle Bobby knows, but I haven't told everybody the extent of what went on in that house. It would serve no purpose to humiliate my father. So I just stay away.
Do you know where Texas is?
When they were.
Oh, 44%. The latest numbers that I read.
When I was a whipping boy, it didn't bother me. I was used to it. But you start fucking with my wife.
Oh. Yeah. Way up in the 50s.
My pops didn't protect his. I'll protect mine. And I'm glad he ain't been by to straighten me out yet.
Americans, thank you, and I yield back.
Because
thank you very much. I'd like to go to Congresswoman
Robin. When I'm wrong, I own it.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
But that whole situation has caused me a lifetime of scars. And some of those scars are still not healed up.
To blunt the impact of Democratic trends that threaten their stranglehold on power.
According to the U.S. Census Bureau, Texas...
I'll do whatever it takes to win.
Nearly 40%...
I will not take another beating from that motherfucker. I will give him everything that he gave my mother and me and my brother and one of my son. And I will not lose to him. Whatever it takes. If he ever tries to lift his hand to me again, he better be ready to kill me because I'll try to kill him. They're having a party at the office tonight. I'm going to stay here with you. I tell them all the time I don't like going in fucking bars. It greatly increases my chance that I'm going to go to jail. Because there's always some drunk asshole whose balls swell up once they start drinking. I'd rather just be home with you. I told him happy birthday. That brother knows I love him. If he don't know I love him, he's fucking retarded. But yeah, I'm on a run. Nate down next month to Florida, Nassau County. And I'm hoping once those papers are served and he's going to be able to see his daughter, that he'll slow the fuck down. The way me and my brothers are, we're all alpha males. They don't tell me what to do, I don't tell them what to do. And I have suggested, and strongly suggested, that my brother slows down. He's just, there's a lot of anxiety that comes along with, you know, having bad health like that. A lot of anxiety goes along with it. And he's just using the coping mechanism that we've always used, you know. I went out to Arizona for 15 years. I got out of the storm. My brothers, they stayed in the storm. And he still hits them bars like we used to when we were 20. My homie Terry, he's probably in the best shape out of all of us, Terry. And he told me one time, he said, "Mark, I can't fucking keep up with him." And I said, "I know, dude. I can't neither." And believe me when I say I was at the hospital with Nate before he got this pacemaker defibrillator in, and they told him they wanted him to stay in the hospital and put him on a heart pump. They wanted him to stay there until he got a heart transplant. They said his heart was so bad it wasn't pumping the blood right.
So it may not look like the full test and the literacy test of old time.
And, the only time I ever lost my legs under me was right there when I got Amy got that call from his ex. They were still together down there, and she said, "Hi, Tara." And, you know, Amy's always all bubbly and shit, but she, like, she bounces out of bed like that. And she, you know, then her demeanor just changed. And I knew something was wrong. And I was like, "What's going on?" And I got the... So I asked her again, "What's going on?" Again, I get the... I said, "God damn it, what the fuck's going on?" And she said Nate had a heart attack and my legs went out from underneath me. I've never had that happen. I didn't think that could happen to me. And I said a horrible thing. I said any one of them but Nate, not Nate.
Voting is not the same as going to the store and buying a bottle of with liquor, and it should never be equated.
Nate's my best friend in the world. We're a lot like each other.
And unfortunately,
he's always putting himself out there for people, and he usually gets kicked in the balls for it too. And then when Nate gets truly violent, is when you fuck with somebody he cares about, and I'm the same way. Most of my fights weren't over me. Somebody fucked with somebody I cared about, and I took it to him. That's what surprised me about my friends in Arizona. Mickey got ripped off one time. I said, I'm going to deal with that motherfucker for you. And he looked at me and he said, why would I want you to get in trouble for my business? And it just blew me. You know, it just blew me away. Because back here, somebody ripped somebody I cared about off, or that's all I felt I had to offer people. And I'd always offer to go deal with it. And it was always, yeah, man, go ahead, you know. And I'm off on a mission. But Mickey said, why would I want you to get in trouble for my business? I wasn't used to that. Now, my brothers didn't. If they had something, you know, like that going on, they'd go deal with it themselves. But other friends, I've had a lot of other friends come up to me and make a point, too, of telling me somebody had fucked them over. And it's because they knew exactly how I was going to react to that. And since I've been home, I've seen a lot of people do that to Nate. And all four times I've seen it happen to Nate since I've been back, turns out the person was lying. Or one example of it, took Nate over to his house and where he was staying at the time. And the gal there goes, she didn't want her boyfriend there no more. Crazy Sheila, I call her. She's nuts. She got a permanent psychosis from smoking that shit. But she goes, I don't want him here no more. And Nate goes, well, whenever he comes over, I'll tell him he needs to leave. I'm thinking, great. So Nate goes, will you get me right up to get a 12-pack real quick, Mark? And I said, sure. We're pulling in the driveway after we got his 12-pack, and guess who's in the front yard? Her boyfriend. So I'm thinking, I'm going to deal with this shit. And I went up. I said, get the fuck out of here, motherfucker. And I started walking towards the door, and he tried to walk past me. He caught an elbow and went stumbling backwards. I said, you hear me, you punk-ass motherfucker? And she opens up the door. And she goes, it's okay. He can come inside. I said, see, Nate? See? And so I'm driving back. I got like a half mile away. And Nate goes, man, he's got two pistols on him. Talking about he's going to shoot you or something. So I went back there and told him, pull him. You know, he didn't pull him. That dude, every time I'm not around, he gets some 40-ouncers in him. He starts talking all tough. And then every time I see him, he's like, hey, Mark, what's up? Nothing but respect, man. And I'm thinking, I got your number, motherfucker, you little bitch. But I was just going to deal with it because, I don't know. But, so yeah, we're going to go down to Nassau County, Florida next month. And get those papers served. That's the mission. I don't like being away from my fucking wife at all, especially since it's become the killing field around here. We had a guy. He was dating this gal. She had a 14-year-old, a 9-year-old, and a 5-year-old. Bastard gets drunk. Not appointed officials, not other elected. Tries to leave with the car. Specifically and only. She tells him she don't want him to drive drunk.
I can't
can't fathom why he would want to see power.
So he told her that he wanted her to give him a ride. She said, I don't have time. I got to make dinner for the kids. Yada, yada, yada. And he, that fucking bastard, shot her in the face in front of the other children. Shot and killed the 14-year-old, the 5-year-old, the 9-year-old was out on the porch and ran, and she got shot through the hand. And then the coward turned the gun on himself. We had an 86-year-old man one street over got killed. They robbed his house, and they killed that old man. They killed that old man. I don't understand that. I don't understand that. Wear a ski mask. Cover your tats. How you gotta kill that old man, you know? I don't understand that. Then the neighbor kid across the street, he gets robbed. Two guys with guns, two doors down. My Uncle Danny's friend owns the barber shop right down the street here. He got robbed at gunpoint. It's fucking crazy. She's got a gun. Every time I leave, I tell her, lock and load. I don't touch it. I don't want to touch the fucking thing. I like knives. But it makes me feel good knowing she's got some protection. If you are a woman and you can legally own a gun, I would highly recommend it. You have to be responsible with it around kids. You got to keep the fucking thing locked up where they can't get to it. Don't think that they won't fuck with it if you tell them not to fuck with it, because they will. You got to keep it locked up. I would recommend you go to classes, learn how to use it, but it is the great equalizer. Any woman knows how to use a pistol will win a fight against any man. It's the great equalizer, and we live in a really dangerous time right now. If I was a woman, well, I'd probably like knives still. I don't know. I'm kind of like, you know, end gun violence, bring back the sword, you know. If I was mad enough to take somebody out, I would want to look them in the eyes when I did it, and at least with a knife, there's some honor to it. It's hand to hand. The guy's got a chance. A gun, these just driving by and spraying bullets is just fucking lazy. Why don't you give me a mooch? What? I love you.
I see you in a little bit.
You look beautiful. I'm going to get off here and eat and clean up. Waiting for Lori to call. But yeah. Lori's got pneumonia. DJ, that's Joe's daughter. He used to bring her out to me and Amy. She was a little bit peanut. Get that picture of DJ out of the bedroom for me. The one where they went to Tombstone. Do you got ours in there too? DJ was a little bit peanut. She grew up into a real pretty young lady. When her dad, Injun Joe, when he died, I was calling her and checking on her a lot. And it did not take me long to realize that this young lady is extremely strong and she's going to be okay. And her mom's a warrior. Mickey, the one I said, probably pound for pound, most dangerous man I ever met. Lori called him out into the desert. She said, let's go out in the desert. She's Lori, I wouldn't want to fucking fight Lori. I love you too. Please be careful. Here's me and Amy.
the voting rights.
I was all skinny then. I was still on fucking pills and shit.
Men?
Oh, yeah, wasn't I?
No.
Oh, I wasn't? Well, no. I was just starting to put on weight. And then this is DJ. I don't know if you can see it. She was just a little peanut.
Baby, be good. Take care of Papa. Mom, I'll be back.
I can take care of myself. I wipe my own ass.
I love you.
I love you, too. You're a pretty bar saloon girl. Well, yeah, I don't know. I ain't been sleeping good. It's kind of weird. I used to be so selfish when I was younger. All I thought about, I mean, I was loyal to my brothers, but all I thought about was Mark, 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 you know, myself. And now I just worry all the time about everybody, and it's all shit I can't control. That's how grandiose I used to be. I used to think I could actually control things. Almost 55 years on the 11th, it'll be 55 years on this earth. God's got sense of humor. But in those years, one thing I have learned is the only thing I can control is myself. And not all the time, most of the time. But yeah, I just wanted to tap in. And been feeling kind of down. I'm going to do another video after I talk to Lori. I need to finish those for kids. Once I get that done, I'm going to organize all my videos. Family ones, ones for my brothers, ones for my kids. Get them all organized. Some of them I'll set to private. You know, I got some private ones I gotta upload for family.
And if you get the vaccine, you can get a
and
that's all that they were offering.
Then once in a great while, I'll do a video just to let people know how I'm doing. But I'll be pretty much done with what I set out to do.
And the governor has prohibited local officials from
I don't know what else I can say to y'all.
So that means that Delta variant that's going around would spread even easier under the election coming up if we don't
have
precautions in place.
Thank you.
Leaving this world's not really a bad thing because if you really look around and see what's going on in the world, the way people treat each other, how low of a value there is on human life nowadays. I'm only 55 years old, but the change in those 55 years, it's almost like everything flipped upside down.
Authorities that are resistant to people's right to vote, but then also empowering partisan actors to overcome
human compassion.
When the officials were trying to protect
love for your neighbor, it's all drying up.
That's exactly right. It's coming at voters, and in this case, their assisters from both directions. We're coming at poll workers from both directions, which is to
only thing that really
with a felony
and
a year
after I wrap all my videos up. I'll still be watching the videos I like, you know, Harvey and Mitch, Lou. There's so many I watched it. Adam, Weeby, bunch of people. It's hard to keep up with all of them.
Finally, Representative Thompson, it was just said by Mr. Franklin that
hopefully Lori will be okay. I hope Dave's okay. I sent him a message, but I ain't heard from him yet.
A lack of courage by coming to Washington to demand federal legislation to protect the right of family. Yes.
Those are the only three left. Well, and Jack. I used to work with Jack Thompson. Yeah, some good times, me and Jack. But this guy we worked for, he was a cheap motherfucker. We had an 18-foot folding step ladder. And me and Jack, we would dig holes, some of them on the commercial stuff, 2 foot by 2 foot by over 3 foot deep, 4 foot deep. And I don't know if you've ever dug through caliche. I've tried taking and using just a hand auger, and you're going to go for a ride. You got to take a 80-pound caliche stick. It's a steel bar, and you got to beat. It's like caliche's as hard as asphalt. It's like beating through asphalt's what it's like. You get down about that far in the desert, and it's sand, and then you hit that caliche layer. That's why monsoon season, when that rain comes down, it just rolls because it can't seep down the ground quick enough. And this bastard had, we'd be sometimes, you know, 20-something foot in the air with sea purlins, metal sea purlins, and we'd take welder's clamps and clamp them to the top of the metal post, and then we'd drill holes and bolt them to the post, and it's always windy out there in the desert. Nate just put something up here. Take my money. Oh my God. I was just talking about 18-foot stepladders. Look what Nate just put up. It says, take my money. And it says 18.5-foot aluminum telescopic ladder. But these were fiberglass. And I kept telling him to do, because he had like plywood and paneling where the ladders had broke, the legs of them, and he put like splints on them. Shot screws through to you know, on a piece of wood or something on the sides of them. And I said, dude, these ladders are fucking dangerous. It's not how far you fall, it's how you land. And I kept telling him, you need to get new ladders, man. You need to get new ladders. Somebody's going to get killed on these ladders. One day I got tired of it, and he was gone, and I took damn skill saw. I cut all his ladder in pieces about this big. And he come back, and both them ladders are just, there's little pieces of ladders all on this big pile. And he goes, what the fuck happened to my ladders? And Jack started laughing. He goes, Mark, he looked at me, he goes, what'd you do? I said, I cut him up, you motherfucker. I told you. I got a wife and kids, man. Fucking, I told you these ladders, because the one leg broke where the splint was on it, and it pissed me off. I was just starting to go up it. And then Amy, we tried for a long time. We were trying like 8 years to have a baby. I lost that one testicle in that fight with a different MC whenever I was 16 and a half. And we tried for 8 years. That's the fact of the law, because I'm sitting here reading. And even in your answer, you didn't tell me. She got pregnant. It's not clear in this bill that people are allowed to actually file complaints, but I got to move on to this. And we woke up at night, and there was blood everywhere. We went to the hospital. If I wouldn't have been in shock, I'd have beat the brakes off that fucking doctor. He reached up, and there was my tongs. He said, well, this pregnancy's over. She had a miscarriage. And she was heartbroken. You know, I already had one kid that was 2 weeks old when I met my ex that I was raising, that I did raise. And then I had my two children by her. I was pretty much kitted out. But she wanted one. And I didn't think that it would be right to deny her one of her own. She was doing such a good job helping me raise mine. but she was devastated. So we got home like 4 in the morning. Like 5:30. He's out there honking the horn. I walked out on the front deck, front porch I built. I said, Amy lost a baby last night. I'm going to stay home with her today. And he started screaming and yelling at me, and I snapped. I went down barefoot, and you don't walk barefoot in Tucson, Arizona, but I did. I went down off that porch, and I had cinder blocks for steps. Well, I slipped, and it raked my ankle on the side of that cinder block, and then I'm stepping on goat heads for like, no matter which way they land, there's two or one spike sticking up on these round things called goat heads. So I'm walking on goat heads as fast as I can towards that truck. And I grabbed it, whenever I come onto the porch, I grabbed that flat, it's just a flathead shovel. And I come around the driver's side of his truck, and he reached over for the glove box, and I knew what was in the glove box. He had a pistol in there. And before he knew what was going on, I had that fucking shovel right on his throat. And I said, go ahead and grab that glove box, motherfucker. And he punched it and took off down the street, and I threw that flathead, and I couldn't have done it in a million years. If I tried again, that son of a bitch stuck in the ground. To stick a flathead shovel in the ground out there, it hit just right. But and the neighbors, Mal and Amos, cross street, them old men, they were laughing their asses off because they didn't like Mark. They didn't like him at all. Jack said they told him, yeah, Mark went after him with the shovel. You know, I think he'd have killed him too. That's Lori. I'm going to have to get going. Love y'all, though. Hey, lady. You don't sound good. You got pneumonia?
Yes, I got pneumonia, COPD.
Oh, shit.
Low white blood cells, and low oxygen, and gallbladder.